the reference to the psychic wolves. Can you talk about a little bit in just their ability to, well, in this case, there seemed to be a telepathic ability.
Yeah, and I'm trying to just make sure that I have the right one that I'm
Okay.
talking. But it is a weird fact that even just the normal, quote unquote normal, upright wolves, wolf or wolf type creatures that people see along the roadside often seem to have a sort of telepathic or empathic ability to, make people feel that they're being given a message, and the messages are pretty specific usually. And the
Like I'm
things,
gonna eat you.
yeah, or even I could jump on the hood of your car
Right.
if I wanted to, or if you tell anybody you saw me, I'll come and get you, I'll find you, that sort of thing. So it starts with that, and then it goes all the way to where people have dog-like or wolf-like entities appearing in their bedroom. They may not be the same creatures that are seen on the roadsides or hiking in trails, but they also seem to have this desire to communicate with the witnesses that most people find very unsettling and spooky because,
Yeah.
it's just not, if you run into any kind of wild animal, I've seen lots of coyotes fairly close, and I don't get the feeling, I don't get any impression from them at all, except they're curious to figure out if I would be prey, and if I'm not, well, then they just, walk away. But I'm not going away with this weird message from them.
Yeah. I found it's kind of curious that there seem to be different types of these creatures. Like some of them have like completely normal human body torsos with just the head of a dog. And then others kind of have the full on, like just a standing wolf creature type of thing.
Right.
So are we dealing with the same thing or are we dealing with different things?
I think we may be dealing with different things because the differences are fairly consistent. And often, when it's the type that has a dog or wolf-like head on a very humanoid body that is with shoulders, and maybe instead of walking on the toe pads, they're walking on the whole foot. Very occasionally, but quite rarely, they may have some clothing on of some type. This is quite different than the ones that are seen on the roadside. And the ones that look more humanoid in the body often usually will have more of an appearance of the, excuse me, I'm sorry. I'm
It's
having
okay.
a few throat problems. I think we said
Yeah.
it earlier. Yeah. Anyway, let me start that part over. It is very likely, in my opinion, that they're very different things because when something is just able to appear in your bedroom, that for one thing tells you that it's not just some solid animal. It's got some
Right.
sort of other latent abilities. And they're often described as reminding people of Anubis, god of the dead, of the ancient Egyptians,
Right.
which is described as having a lot of muscles, a very humanoid body with shoulders again, which canines do not ordinarily have
Yeah.
shoulders. If you picture a dog when it's sitting down and its legs will just go smoothly from its neck down to the floor. Whereas if a person's sitting there, you're going to see those shoulders sticking out. So there's a difference, and I think that it may be the same sort of difference that, for instance, you see different types of human figures. There are the ordinary walking around type human figures that are you and me. People sometimes can project what's called the astral double, and somebody on the other side of the world could see an exact replica of you while you're sitting and watching TV in your living room, or sleeping or something like that. We also see manifestations of humans that appear to be partly transparent or maybe missing, they're floating around, missing their legs, whatever. We think of those as ghosts,
Right.
and there are different types of those too. And then there are other manifestations of things that are almost human, like almost every culture has its little people, which would be very diminutive, but very humanoid little sentient beings.
Like elves or gnomes.
Elves or gnomes, or the Native American Pukwudgi that inhabit stream beds and stream areas.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you hear growling, that's not me. That's my dog.
I hear him. You have a wolf man there.
I've got a little wolf guy. Yep. His name is Grendel because he is monstrous. And,
oh, my goodness.
monstrous.
You must sense that we're talking about monsters.
Yes. Yes, I think so. He's wanting me very badly to take his little toy squirrel and throw it for him.
Oh.
So, but he's going to have to just wait a little bit till that one gets home.
So, oh, yep. My goodness.
I see you there. Sorry. This just seems to be one of these nights. You know, sometimes radio shows end up strange for no reason.
I wonder why.
Yeah.
Right? I think, you know, sometimes when you're discussing a topic, it almost brings the energy, as in the law of attraction. It draws it kind of towards you.
Yes.
One of those things.
That's true. And, you know, there's another form of these strange canines that my Native American friends don't like to talk about, and in fact say the name shouldn't even be uttered aloud, but it's the skinwalker.
Oh, I actually really wanted to talk about that tonight, so yeah.
Yeah, and that's another type that may be a projection of mental energy or an astral form by people who are trained to do this kind of work. And so that's another entirely different form. There are also some of these that don't happen to walk on two legs. I call them quads, and I've really collected quite a number of these sightings right from the beginning, and may put them all together perhaps in the very near future and just talk about them. But they almost look like a throwback to some of the original bear/wolf or dog ancestors, such as the Amphisian or other. There are a few types of very ancient, no longer living creatures that have both characteristics, and they're pretty gnarly looking. They have kind of razorback tufts on the ridge of their spines. Their huge heads are very noticeable. They'll have giant teeth that were made for just kind of mashing bone, and you wouldn't want to run into one of those.
No, it doesn't sound like it. I think I'd run the other way.
Yeah, but and there's really no explanation for their being there. You know, they don't relate to any modern contemporary animal. But it was so long ago that they existed that it seems chances are very slim. Some people think that they resemble dire wolves, which are much more recent. And you can find lots of models of those if you go out and visit the La Brea tar pits, say, in California. Yeah. And they were also very formidable animals. But, you get all these types. And then I know other people have suggested that there are still more types, that some are what they call specially bred soldier dogs that they believe might be some kind of genetically manipulated being.
Now, that makes sense. The government is always messing around with stuff like that to try to weaponize it and do things like that. But the other ones that you were talking about recently, they're kind of like an older creature that, you know, you might think would be extinct. It leads me into the thought of, you know, you were talking in your book about the underground systems that seem to have creatures in them, and perhaps things that may have logically supposed to be extinct may have survived living underground, you know, in these things, which may explain some of these, you know, experiences that people have with creatures that, you know, are in tunnels and cave systems and things.
Yes. And you know what? It's amazing that you just said that, because I had a report today from a man I know who is a county sheriff's deputy and who over the past, I don't know, 6 years or so has actually witnessed, while on his third shift rounds, four different wolfmen type creatures.
Oh my goodness.
And I got a call today from his wife. They were driving from Michigan back to Wisconsin, and he happened to look out. She didn't see it because I think she was taking a nap at the time, but he happened to look out in this field to the side of the car, and only about, I think he said 40 feet away, it was quite nearby, he saw in broad daylight the form of a wolf man, which appeared to be, he said there was something odd about its stance, but it appeared to be on its belly, and then kind of just crawled, got up to a kneel, and then stood up with its face turned away from him, and then just walked off on its hind legs into the woods. And she said it had an odd color, like the color of peanut butter, which is not a color anybody has really reported to me about these things before.
That's more of a Bigfoot color.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like I call them the cinnamon Bigfoots, you know. And he has seen Bigfoot, too, up in the wild. He has a cabin up in Michigan, and I've been there and visited the spot where the Bigfoot was seen and everything. But he said he recognized the shape of it immediately. Mm-hmm. And it occurred to me, I said, do you think that the reason it was on its stomach, because I've never, ever, in 25 years, hundreds of reports that I still receive quite frequently every week, never heard of anyone saying that it was on its belly. Now that I said that, I just recalled one incident in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where one lone wolf man was seen crawling through a field on its belly, commando style. Kind of like, you know what I mean, where you're flat out and the elbows are moving and you're kind of pushing, they're pushing with their feet
what
on the ground.
What they do when they go through basic training.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. But this one, you know, wasn't seen to be really crawling like that. And it just seemed odd that it would have been lying on its stomach out in this field where she said there was just kind of a remainder of whatever had been grown in that field, and it was just sort of variations of the same color as this creature's fur, which again is very odd.
Yeah, because most of the sightings that you had that you mentioned in the book were very black, very dark fur, almost like shadow type beings, and some of them in fact were shadow beings.
Yes, exactly. And I do get reports of gray ones. Once in a very rare blue moon, you'll hear of a white one. The most are described as dark brown or black, you know, with the occasional gray. But I've never heard of one that was that kind of reddish tan that you'd expect of peanut butter. So that, and then the weirdest thing about this particular sighting was that as it stood up and began to walk off, this dark mist appeared around it, and it sort of disappeared into the mist.
Oh, wow. Well, that kind of goes to, you know, the gateway discussion, like portals and things. Perhaps it went from, you know, our physicality to a different one, like perhaps where it came from.
Yeah, and the whole thing just sounded to me like it was coming up out of the ground. And
that's interesting.
Yeah, and you'll find a lot of ancient biblical references and other ancient cultural references, and especially I think there are some from some of the testaments that didn't make it into the Bible too, where it talks about beasts coming up from the ground and living in caves. And I also I like to just go to unusual sources to get speculative possibilities and theories and answers for these things. And some years ago, I happened to meet a woman from Milwaukee who is an animal psychic. And she will actually, people will hire her to come and talk to their animals when they seem sick and they can't figure it out, or if the animal's having a problem. And I happened to see her at this one event really come up with some remarkable conclusions and things that she shouldn't have been able to know. So I asked her to just use the drawing that I made called The Indigenous Dog Man, which is in some of my early books, and which I did after people would describe their sightings to me, and I would draw them. Mm-hmm. And she did this, and she said where she found herself was deep, dark, in some type of tunnel or cave. And she felt that she was talking telepathically to like an overbeing or kind of a master of all of these creatures, a master animal. And it felt very aloof to her. She said she felt that it was superior in many ways, extremely intelligent, extremely old. And what it conveyed to her was that we've been here longer than you have, and when you're gone from this planet, we will still be here.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, and the fact she just had this complete impression that it was down in these tunnels and caverns.
Which, yeah, like I said, it seems like a place where, you know, things that perhaps want to avoid humanity, because, I mean, we are very aggressive in general. It makes sense for them to live kind of out of our sight so that they have as little interaction with us as possible. Mm-hmm. Except for, you know, when they come to observe us. It seems like there's an ongoing theme through a lot of the stories of, you know, a sense of these, especially the ones that show up in people's bedrooms, just watching mm-hmm. them, kind of like a traditional shadow person does, you know, the man in the hat. But these are wolf men.
Right, right. And I was surprised that some of these shadow figures, wolf shadows, mm-hmm. appeared outdoors to people. You know, it wasn't just in the bedroom. There's one right. story in the book, in one of the southern states, where an entire large extended family, they were all outside. They had like a garden. There was a little cornfield nearby. And somebody noticed there was this shadowy black figure by the tree line. And they looked, and it was like the outline of a great black wolf. They could only see one eye. And when it turned toward them, they said they could see that it was just like if you were looking at a cardboard cutout, and then you looked at the edge of it, and you saw how thin it really was.
That's so strange.
It is. And then it turned the other way, and they could see the eye on the other side of it. I mean, who could make this up? And I talked to two different family members about it, mm-hmm. and their stories were exactly the same. And the grandma saved the day by running and getting a broom and, you know, kind of starting to chase at it with the broom. And it walked off through the field or the garden and disappeared from view. But this was broad daylight. And I had another woman who, her and her sister live someplace in central Wisconsin that seems to be absolutely infested with these things. And it's right near the Ho-Chunk reservations.
I'm Ho-Chunk, by the way.
Oh, okay. Okay. Great. Well,
which one? Was it Blue Wing?
No, it's closer to Black River Falls.
Okay.
And their property is directly across, and they have many friends in the Ho-Chunk community. Mm-hmm. And I've actually been able to...
Is this Pam and Molly that you're in the
books?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Okay. I wanted to talk to you about them because, yeah, I think there's... Go ahead and tell their story, because I think there's more going on there than even they might understand.
Oh, wow. Well, I'll try and give a quick rundown of it. If you read that, then you know it's very long and convoluted. And,
yes.
And I've heard from her recently. And for anyone who doesn't have the book, there are photos of Bigfoot structures that I found. Mm-hmm. One of the best examples of what they call hut structures that I've ever seen. I've got a picture of my husband standing in it. Just kind of a phenomenal interweaving of these things.
Yes.
And they started out just kind of mildly with seeing Bigfoot. They each had Bigfoot sightings, and then he started wolfmen and something that looked like a kangaroo began showing up in their backyard. And they were so freaked out by that, they forbid their kids to play in the backyard unless they were out there with them, which is why they totally stopped going in the woods at the back end of the yard.
Yeah.
So they had no idea that there were structures of any kind in that woods. They just, none of them had been in there. Yeah. But this actually led to poltergeist activities within the house. Mm-hmm. Water faucets would suddenly turn themselves on and off. One of them saw what was described to them by one of your tribal members as a thunderbird. Actually, it was a giant.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. And so it was almost like something was seeking them out.
Exactly. Yeah. That now, if I remember right, they're near tribal land. Is that correct? Some old burial mounds and things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That may have a lot to do with it. But I found a lot of correlations with their experiences and my own, especially when I was coming into my shamanic awakening. And I actually had a thunderbird come to me as well.
Oh, wow.
But I wasn't at home. See, I live in Oklahoma now, so I'm so far from home. But all of those things, you know, they had lights as well, did they not?
Yes.
Yeah.
Light, I mean, it's just about, like, you name it.
Everything.
It's there.
Mm-hmm. And this is kind of what I think led me down the path of starting to go into research on the possible connection between everything being connected, UFOs, poltergeist, paranormal phenomena, you know, mm-hmm. crypto creatures. There seems to be a link between all of these things.
There does. Mm-hmm. And again, you just said something amazing because you nailed my premise for this new book, which if you've read it, you know that I'm trying to look for connections in all of these reports that come to me. And it just so happened that the past several years, I've gotten many, many more of these reports where it's not just the dog man that stands upright, turns around, right. looks at you, and then runs back into the woods. It's things that come with lights, that was glowing blue, strange sun flares that are happening at the same time, UFOs in the same vicinity and time frame. And I started looking up, just actually researching some of the more outstanding stories, especially those that mentioned these sorts of things and that had viable dates where I could find things, you know, in, say... you know, there's several different online references for UFO sightings by state and county and time. And we have the same thing for Bigfoot sightings.
Uh-huh.
So it just seemed to me that there were more correlations than you would expect by chance.
Mm-hmm. I give an example of one. I think it was around 2008. Mother's Day, we were doing a campfire we often did in our backyard, and we saw lights coming out over our field, and they were different colors in a triangle formation, and we thought maybe it's helicopters or something, but we never did quite figure that out. But a few days later, I was going to the store with my mother-in-law and my youngest son, well, actually my oldest son at the time, and we're in the car, and there's a field to the left of us, and houses on the right. And I see out of the corner of my eye over in the field, there's this thing. It looks like a beaver, kind mm-hmm. of. I mean, it's blurry because it's going fast, but it looks like a beaver, but like a beaver that's swimming in the air. Okay.
That's weird.
So it's moving in the air, kind of in, you know, like a dolphin swim type of formation, you know, up and down that gyrating area. And as we get up to the stop sign, it's next to us the whole way up, and we're all kind of looking at this thing, wondering what it is. As we get up to the stop sign, it crosses the road that will be to the left of us, and as it gets across the road, it drops into a human-type form, a humanoid form, and it looks like a Bigfoot at this point.
Oh, wow.
And it continues to walk down their driveway and past the side of their garage and into their backyard. So I turn left because that's the way I'm going anyways. And I look over to the right as I'm going by it, and it's gone. I can't see anything. But wow. That was one of the absolute strangest. But it correlated within days of the UFO sighting that we had had as well.
Ah.
So that was one of those things that kind of clicked those little buttons into place as how are these things connected?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, one theory is that there is sort of a spirit matrix that mm-hmm. kind of lives and inhabits the whole earth, just a little bit out of our own electromagnetic field or our own vibratory frequency, however you want to put it, and that can shapeshift, take other forms, interact with us through our minds and in our own spirits, and generally just appear whatever way it wants to suit its purposes. I've also heard that medicine men who are trained in this can travel as a ball of light and then manifest into whatever form they're trying to take fast or to be able to go from one place to another and go out and do things. So that's, I don't know if I just explained that very well, but I have seen that quite a number of places where, in fact, one of the First Nation names for these creatures that travel in the ball of light and then shapeshift is literally, it goes fast.
Which that thing did.
Really? That's fascinating. It's, I mean, I've had my own sphere of light experience, which is described in the book at the end. It was about a year ago, and again, we were thinking it was airplanes. I was sitting and surveying a field where all kinds of really weird, weird things have happened, and weird footprints and lights and that sort of thing. And we thought that we were just watching airplanes on their flight path, and then one of them all of a sudden stopped, just stopped flying and went backwards.
Yeah.
It wasn't like vibrating. It just stopped and went backwards. And I was sitting in the back seat, and the property owner and my colleague who had come with us that evening were sitting in the front. Sanjay Singhal is his name. And I said, guys, that one's not an airplane. And they looked, and when we gave it our attention, our combined attention, and I think that's probably a very important part of it, it started heading across the field toward us in like a straight beeline.
Wow.
And we were just watching in amazement. We didn't think to, I mean, I was holding a camera, but it was a little far away yet, and I was thinking, well, this is just some kind of light. Maybe
illusion or something.
Drone, or maybe I was thinking maybe even a drone. Until it got to about 30 feet away from us. And it was about 20, 30 feet in the air, about 30 feet from the car, maybe. And it was maybe the size of a basketball. It was lit by its own self somehow, but it wasn't really emitting light.
Right.
And it just was sort of hovering there. And I was just getting, you know, I got my mind back, and I was just pulling my camera up to hit the video button, and Sanjay grabbed a flashlight and shined it out his open car window at it. And when the flashlight beam hit it, we all had this strong impression that it was hesitating and surprised. It was very surprised that happened. And then it just, while that beam was on it, it didn't instantaneously vanish as soon as the beam hit, as it might have, as if it were just some puff of mist or illusion.
Right.
It stayed for a moment, and then it just kind of winked itself out, kind of the way an LED light will wink itself out, and was just gone. And we all just yelled simultaneously different things.
I'm sure.
You know, we couldn't believe it. It was completely against the laws of physics, everything that we had just seen. Yeah. And three pretty trained observers seeing it, and there it was, you know.
Yeah.
So, and I will say that this particular area, I have learned, was at one time right at the center of a network of very ancient pathways that our Native American people would take to go around to their summer camps. And it was full of effigy mounds, animal-shaped ones, and the round ones, too. There are tons of effigy mounds in all around through this area. But when I drew it out, it almost looks like a medicine wheel with completely true north and south spokes that are one road, and it's crossed right in the center with an east-west layout, and then there are other divisions, you know, kind of like a pie. And the center of it would be not that far from where we were sitting.
Huh. You know, I noticed that there are an awful lot of experiences that come out of Wisconsin. It seems to be very, very centralized. Do you find that there's a hot spot in that area?
Yeah, I think there are several, you know, and some people have suggested that, well, Wisconsin isn't that much more active. It's just that people learned about me collecting these stories early on and started sending me the stories. However,
I don't know.
it is pretty active, and especially the southern half, where all these animal effigy mounds are located. And these have always been a special interest of mine. And I think the latest research shows that nobody really knows exactly who made them, but it's thought that they were ancestors of the Ho-Chunk, from what I've heard. And because they correspond very closely to the Ho-Chunk totem animals. And the mind-bending fact is that southeastern Wisconsin has something like 96% of the world's, of the known world's ancient animal-shaped effigy mounds.
And you know what's horrible is that we're fighting to protect them now because there are gravel companies that are trying to destroy them.
It's unthinkable. Well, the ones that are still there. I mean,
yeah,
there were literally thousands of them in this area when the settlers came and began recording it. And it looked like park gardens. It didn't look like it does today. They were tended carefully. They were beautifully delineated. These were not crude markings. These were very planned and very carefully outlined shapes that were put into the soil. Some are like over 100 feet long. I think there's a Thunderbird effigy mound in Madison that is like 120 feet long, and some bigger, and they were arranged carefully on the landscape so that, say, a parade of ducks or some other type of animal could be seen to look. If you looked at it from above, it would look like this group of animals marching down to the water. And
kind of like Nazca, but in mounds.
Yes, yeah, exactly, and perhaps more carefully placed. Mm-hmm. You know, there definitely seemed to, and they were especially to be found by fresh water, fresh springs, which I'm sure you know were believed to be the doorways to the spirit world, and where these would come in and out. And I did have, so it was like terraforming. You know, the landscape was made sacred and was like one big, giant, wonderful sacred art project that I just think, oh, if only we could have had aerial photos of how that looked at the time.
Yeah.
And the woodlands were burned out and tended so that they didn't look like these forests we have now today with thorns and all kinds of weeds and buckthorn everywhere. They looked like parks. Beautifully tended parks. It was a very, very different habitat in those days. And the reason this is all very interesting to me, and the reason that I was able to get an interview with one of the tribal leaders who's also an anthropologist, I don't think she'd want me to mention her name, but I'm sure you would probably know her, was because I was looking one day at a new book that had come out on the effigy mounds, and they had a map of where certain types of them were located in clusters. You know, not every single one of them, but clusters of certain types. And there was one that the early settlers erroneously called lizard mounds, but the people actually referred to them as either water panther mounds or water spirit mounds, because they had these very, very long tails. So I was looking at where the clusters for these water spirit mounds were, and I thought, that looks really familiar. And I pulled out a map that I'd made of just clusters of dog-man or man-wolf sightings around southern Wisconsin, and it was almost a complete overlap.
Wow.
I was able to take two cellophane overlays and place one over the other. And I used to show this at some of my talks, and people would just gasp because it was so striking. And the part of the idea is that these may have been some sort of guardian figures.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
And then the settlers come along, break open the mounds, and things go out that were meant to be perhaps contained. And that perhaps is, you know, the origin of these things. Maybe they became more solidified as time wore on. Maybe they were able to go back to some other place that they had come from. That those things, I don't know.
That was exactly what I was thinking as you were talking about that, is that, you know, these appearances of these wolf men are actually like guardians of these ancestral sites and areas. And there were different stories that you mentioned in which, you know, they would watch or they would give a menacing feel, like the one with the girl who repeatedly saw them over years' time in her family. And that's kind of what felt to me is like, this spirit didn't harm her, but it was constantly almost being like a watchful guardian over the land itself.
That could be, yeah, because they couldn't get rid of it. And it did have shape-shifting abilities, because if that's the one I'm thinking of, it was always sort of trying to lure the family members outside.
Yeah.
And one time she went out and saw her brother standing by the tree line, and was kind of thinking, oh, what's he doing there? And then she turned around and saw that her brother was inside the house.
Yeah.
And then she turned around again and saw that it was the wolf-like creature coming toward her. And so she ran up on the porch. But so often people are pursued, their cars are chased, or they are chased even out in the open. And they're sure that it is going to overtake them and get them and eat them or whatever. And then at the last minute, and this is over 25 years in all but one instance, and that I'll tell you about in a second. It either jumps into the cornfield or the woods or whatever's there. In a few cases, it seems to vanish and doesn't harm the person.
Yeah.
Although I always cautioned there could be some who didn't live to tell the tale.
Right.
You know, but I've often also told this other story that one man in Quebec, Canada, did say that he encountered one on a trail. He wasn't armed or anything, and it lunged sort of toward him, and he panicked and feels that he jumped the wrong way, and it accidentally grazed the skin. It went through his shirt and grazed his flank and upper hip on his side and required quite a few stitches to close.
Oh, wow.
And he told them that it was a bear because he didn't want to say what it really was. Huh. But he felt that it wasn't intending. He said, if it had meant to get me at that closeness, you know, it could have just, you know, torn right into me and or knocked me over and I wouldn't have had a chance. But that's been very consistent. And I've heard other people say they've experienced, you know, big attacks or believe that it's massacred people or something like that. But I don't comment on those because that hasn't been the experience of my reports, and I haven't had the chance to talk to those people or, you know, be able to really give my own thoughts on it. So it could be, I don't know for sure, but it has not been my experience in these 25 years. And, and I don't feel that the 25 years have made me any sort of an expert. I'm still just as puzzled as I was.
I know exactly what you mean. I have been experiencing paranormal things since I was at least 3 or 4 years old. And to this day, you know, I still don't understand everything. I'm still looking for answers. That's all we can do is continue to get information and analyze it and just try to gather the best we can in understanding. But I don't think we'll ever fully understand.
Right, right. I think more of myself as a longtime, very serious student of these phenomena and investigator. But, I mean, in almost every case, people are still left guessing. And I do think there are different forms of the canine creature. And perhaps they serve different purposes. Perhaps they come from different places. They don't all seem exactly the same.
No, they certainly don't. And the ones that I'm thinking of right now are the ones that appear during sleep paralysis. You talked about that, and I kind of almost wonder if these are actually astral visitors. And that is why they are seen during that time period in between the sleep and the wakefulness, is because they're actually not there physically in the room, but because you are in the astral at that time, you see them clearly as they see you clearly, because you're both on that same plane.
Yes. Yeah, I think so. And I've had some of those astral experiences ever since we moved to this area. We actually live right at the edge of the Kettle Moraine State Forest, or we did until about a week ago. My husband and I moved to downsize, but we're still pretty close. Close, but not as close as we were, where my office was literally 12 feet from a drop down into one of the kettles. Right. And, you know, I can tell you about those experiences some other time. But it's very active. That whole area is very active with the Dogman and especially the Bigfoot. In fact, I've had more, not astral experiences, but daylight full waking experiences with some of the Bigfoot myself. Just in the past 4 years, it's kind of like once it starts, it starts.
Uh-huh. And yeah, it's like a doorway has been opened almost. But it's actually, I think, more like a veil has been pierced. When people get to a certain level, they almost become like an antenna for things to say, hey, guess what? I can see you. And so they get drawn to you more because you're someone they can communicate with in showing themselves and being around. And I'm not so certain that everyone can always see these beings.
I think that's probably true, because I'll get reports from people where there's usually one person in the group in every case that doesn't see it.
Yeah.
Not always. I mean, you know, I think of that family where they all saw it when they were outdoors, but very often there's one that doesn't see it. And there are people who
Closed.
Yeah, exactly. They'll walk by or drive by the same place day after day after day after day after day after day. Mm-hmm. And then somebody like Pam or Molly from that family comes by, and bingo, they see a 7 foot tall cinnamon colored Bigfoot standing down in the creek, you know, when they look over the bridge.
Yeah.
And then there are often footprints and things like that to help substantiate when people have those experiences.
Yeah. And in regards to Pam and Molly, they are definitely being given some sort of a message. Now, it might be land related, but it really feels very strongly to me like one or both of them are being called to awaken to a certain path.
Hmm.
And so that's something that, if they're listening, they need to consider. And if you might just pass that message on to them, because usually when this much activity happens around an individual, it is a calling, usually to some sort of a spiritual path, often a healer path. And so sometimes it can also be connected with physical illnesses and ailments that are somewhat mysterious and can be somewhat serious. And that will continue until they accept that path and start walking it. So you might ask them, you know, if you're still in contact with them, you know.
I am. Yeah, I just heard from you a few days ago, actually.
Yeah.
So, it's quieted down a little bit. And sometimes that happens when somebody tells me their story and it gets, I post it or it gets in one of my books.
Things settle down.
It settles down
for
some reason, you know, and people will every now and then be having these.
Comes in waves.
It comes in waves. Yeah. And very often they're helped by either prayer or blessing or sage sweepings, whatever their system is. And then I also tell them, just, you know, light the heck out of the place. Put floodlights that you can operate from indoors or that are motion sensitive. Put on an extra porch light. Keep a big flashlight handy. Mm-hmm. Put electronic devices if you can afford a trail cam. Because these things do hate this stuff.
Yeah.
And will avoid
it. They don't like being caught on camera.
No. And it sometimes is enough to make them just go elsewhere. So...
Yeah, that's a good way. If you're wanting to get rid of something, the best way to do it is start getting equipment to get evidence of it, because they just avoid it like the plague. I remember when we were having, like, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, we were having a lot of paranormal activity started kicking up again. And so I got, you know, a voice recorder, I got some night vision camera and stuff, and all of a sudden everything starts disappearing that I got.
Yeah.
And it turns up later, like, under a sink in the bathroom at the back corner with something. Wow. I mean, in the weirdest places. It's like, you know, just hide it, get it away, take it someplace else, and it won't appear again until, you know, you've completely forgotten and you're no longer interested in getting the evidence.
Yeah, and when I've had experiences with the Bigfoot, for instance, I had a 35-foot-long, 8-inch diameter living oak branch torn off of a tree maybe 150 feet from me right before my very eyes.
Oh, wow.
That's in, if you go to my blog, lindagodfrey.com, and you go to, you can just put in the search box there, Bigfoot branch, and you can pull it up and see the whole story and and see the evidence and pictures that are there. I went back and verified it with, I had a friend of mine who was married to a Lakota Sioux man who has studied medicine and who does authentic artwork for a living, actually. And she came with her 21-year-old daughter, and they went back down in that kettle with me about half an hour later, and the daughter actually saw it. And we all heard, and it growled at us, and it scented the area for us. It's a nice way of putting it. But, you know, people run and walk past that area, and I had for many years, without ever thinking about it. It was just that one morning. And the other sightings I've had were maybe half a mile away in a field near where I would go for walks all the time. And one time it was just, I noticed this black head sticking up above this hayfield. And I thought, why did that farmer put a fence post right out there? And as I thought that, I looked back at it again. And the minute I gave it my attention, it slowly lowered itself down into the cornfield. And it wasn't that far away. It was, all I could see was black fur because it was backlit by the sun. But I just backed up and walked away. I had another one where there was this weird stump in a cornfield. And again, I was looking at it and was close enough to see that it wasn't a clump of turkeys. It was a black color. The only other thing I thought of was a bear, but no bear sits still and contorts its body. They just don't do that. If they want to run away, they run away. Yeah, my dad's from northern Wisconsin. I grew up walking around those woods, and I've seen bears in the wild many times. They just do what they want to do, you know. And this thing, I figured it out later, it had to have been sitting in a squat position with one toe kind of pointed toward me and one arm, because it looked to me like a stump with a branch growing out of it. And I realized later that the branch had to be its arm kind of, it was like I had interrupted it in mid stride or mid crawl. And I was actually driving, I saw this from my car, I was driving very slowly past that field because there are often, it's usually full of deer, sometimes as many as 40 deer at a time. My husband and I call it the animal field, or the wild animal field.
Well, pretty much everywhere in Wisconsin is full of deer.
That's true. That is true.
Yeah.
But I backed up. I stopped and I backed up. I had gotten just past where it was in my line of vision. Mm-hmm. It was about maybe 40 feet from a tree line that was a kettle. These kettles just get left in the middle of cornfields because they're too deep and impossible to, to farm.
Right.
And just within about 2 seconds' time, literally no more than that, it was gone. It had scuttled, or it probably ran at breakneck speed and dove down into that kettle just the second my eyes were off of it.
Wow.
And there's nothing else that would have done that, that could have been that size. So, but again, none of these times did I have a camera with me at the time of the sighting.
Yeah, I find that's the case oftentimes.
Not even a cell phone.
Here's the thing, though. Oftentimes, especially with UFOs, whenever you're in the moment of a sighting, the idea of getting something kind of goes away from your mind because you're so in that moment.
Yes.
You're just you know, enraptured with that, that you can't even think about doing something else because you don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss a second of what's happening.
Exactly, exactly. I've been in that position more than once. I had seen actually one of those basketball-sized light spheres while I was investigating for the book Weird Michigan. Mm-hmm. And I had to go down in this basement of this very old brick building that was supposed to be haunted in Manistee, Michigan. And there was a male spirit that people often said they saw either around the building or behind it in the parking lot. It was supposed to be a young man who died of diphtheria back around the 1900s, mm-hmm. named William, and they called him Basement Billy. He had even had a nickname.
Oh my goodness.
And, the building's owner took me down in the basement. It was just bare floor. Any ductwork was wrapped. It was a huge space. There was only one light bulb at the far end, nothing else in there. And I said, well, let's just, and I just had to be there, take a picture. I wasn't expecting anything at all.
Right.
And I said to her, why don't we just turn off the light and stand here in the dark for a minute, see if anything happens. You know, so I could kind of really, I had a lot of places to go in that day, and I was just kind of trying to get the photo and of the building and go. Well, we stood there, and within a minute or two, lo and behold, this basketball-shaped thing, maybe only 10 feet away from me and almost right at the height of the 7-foot ceiling, appeared.
Wow.
And it was, again, self-lit. It wasn't casting any light on anything. And I thought, this, my eyes are playing tricks. And I turned my head, looked away, and I looked back, and it was still there. And I had this feeling that it was curious, you know, aware, trying to figure out what was going on. And when I finally got my wits about me enough to reach for the camera that was hanging around my neck and go to take the picture, then it just kind of slowly faded out.
Right?
Just so
it's the worst.
Yeah, so I have a nice picture in that it says, the title for that, the editors titled it Weird Michigan Sees Basement Billy, and there's a nice picture of the owner in the basement, but not Billy. But here's the really interesting thing about that experience. The owner also saw it, but what she saw was the full figure of the young man.
Oh.
And we were both too shocked to say anything at the moment, but then we immediately compared notes. And my only way of explaining that is she had expectations and images in her mind, I think, of what it looked like as as the apparition, you know, the human apparition. And I had no expectations whatsoever, didn't really know what it looked like. And I just saw the pure, I just call it an electromagnetic light form.
Wow. I've seen light, but not in a spherish form. However, I've seen a sphere-shaped UFO that was self-illuminated, like you mentioned, but it was like the size of a Volkswagen.
Oh, wow.
We were in Sparta, Wisconsin at that time. I grew up in Wisconsin.
Yeah, so. I have relatives who still live around Sparta.
Yeah.
So I know that area really well.
It was near Fort McCoy.
Oh, yeah. Yep. I know exactly where that was. Yeah.
And that one. But as far as the light phenomena, when I was, and I didn't know at the time I was close to death, but I was really close to death. I'd wake up with these glowing mists over me. Now, sometimes it would be a red mist, and whenever it was the red mist, it scared me. It, like, I knew that there was a malicious intent with the red mist, and it was like a red glowing mist that was right in front of me.
Mm-hmm.
And it would go as soon as I woke up. But the white mist almost seemed like it was protecting me from the red mist. And this was a really bright white light that would just float over me. As soon as I got where I wasn't near death anymore, they were gone. They didn't come back.
Really?
Yeah.
And how did you interpret them?
I'm not exactly sure, but the white one certainly felt like a guardian of some sort.
It's neat that you had the balance and you had the two.
Yeah.
But that's very interesting. Yeah, and these light forms show up in conjunction with the Dogman sightings. There was one that I had in my book, Real Wolfmen, True Encounters in Modern America, that a woman had called me and told me about her experience where she and her husband saw five of them stalking them as they sat on their front porch, just watching, just having coffee about 10:30 one night, and they put on their yard light and saw three coming toward him and three on the other side, or two on the other side coming toward her. And before that, they had noticed strange white lights in the orchard adjacent to that property. And again, this was in Maine, in a rural but not like a wilderness area.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular story was picked up by a sci-fi paranormal witness. Did a show on it. They exaggerated those lights quite a bit, but there were lights, you know. And I think that show as much as, or that particular story, not the show so much, but that story was one of those that started me really thinking about these connections because, you know, you hear that and you wonder why, you know, mm-hmm. seems entirely too coincidental that two such strange anomalies would happen.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, we are at the end of the hour, so we're getting ready to go to break. So, before we end to go to break, I just want to thank you for being with us tonight. I know you weren't feeling great. And I want everyone, if you want to hear more, because there are so many stories in her book, Monsters Among Us, An Exploration of Otherworldly Bigfoots, Wolfmen, Phantoms, and Other Phenomena. Thank you so much, Linda.
Oh, you're welcome. It's a pleasure. We'll have to talk a little bit more.
Yes. Welcome back, everyone. You are listening to Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio. I just want to mention real quick, if you guys are enjoying listening to the station, if you enjoy this show, if you enjoy all the other shows on the station, please take a minute to visit the homepage and click on the support or the donate buttons, visit the shop. This station is 100% listener supported, and so we rely on the kindness and generosity of wonderful listeners like you to help us keep the station going. And with that, I'd like to welcome Rodrigo to the studio with me. Hey.
Hey, Lenita. How are you doing?
Wonderful. So
That's good. It's
been an interesting week for us here in the United States.
Yes.
So how does the rest of the world see... How does Australia see and view what's happening with our transition of power, the presidency that's coming up in January?
Well, I don't know how it's perceived by other Australians. I can only tell you how it's like in this household. It's been a war of between a woman elect president and a male elect president. So my daughter, you know, she's young, she's 13, and go the female president, right?
Right.
Obviously doesn't understand the full context of what it means to have, you know, certain policies that Clinton would have introduced, but she was versed enough to make a valid comment. For me, I was, you know, not really choosing sides, but I was just playing the devil's advocate and saying to her that I was voting Trump, that I would have voted for Trump just to incite a reaction. Of course, I've had my other experiences with other people from around the world, their perceptions of or their point of views from what has occurred. And I believe I told you before, you know, I came online that there was a, well, I don't know this person's age. I won't even mention if they're female or male, but they managed to get emails of he said Secret Service email servers. I don't know what that meant in regards to whether it was White House or whether it was a private home of Trump, but they managed to get emails which, how would I say it, would have incriminated him on criminal behavior. And they managed to get access to these emails yesterday. And they were pooping in their pants, to say it nicely, because I'm very worried whether they'd be caught or the federal, you know, police or whatever it is in the United States would come after them. So that was interesting, and I don't know what it meant. It was something to do about some sexual allegations, and I don't know much about that. Has there been sexual allegations against Trump?
There actually has, yes. He has I think it's a civil case, but he has a child rape case against him that he's supposed to be going to court on, I think this month or next month, for a 13-year-old girl. So we'll see where that goes. You know, nobody believes anything right now, especially those who support him, that he's capable of doing anything wrong. However, the fact remains we have, you know, what came out on WikiLeaks about Hillary and about her husband's situations, that they're saying that, you know, there's that he flew very frequently on Jeffrey Epstein's airline, which was called Lolita Air or something like that, which was supposedly Epstein is well known to be a pedophile and to have a island that is like a sex island that is, you know, I guess, all underage girls, and that Clinton apparently, it's said that he visited many times and he flew on the airline many times, but it's also said that Trump has been on that airline as well, and that he, it's a quote that he's actually said that he thinks that Jeffrey Epstein is a great guy. So, given that we know he's a pedophile, who knows, you know, but that is one of those things that's kind of out there right now. And it certainly may threaten, if it threatens his presidency, it still threatens Hillary's as well, because, you know, if they're going to go by what came out of WikiLeaks, then it threatens Hillary as well, because I've heard that she's going to be pardoned. I hope that's not the case, because we really had a horrible decision this year. I mean, and I refused it. I just simply did. I'm sorry, and I don't feel like I threw away my vote. What I did was I was taking a stand and refusing to support a broken system. The two-party system is broken. It's been broken for a long time, and I refuse to be a part of it. So I voted third party. I voted for Jill Stein.
Okay.
But when we came down to the two parties, you know, the biggest problem was is that the DNC rigged the elections so that Hillary was their representative, which it shouldn't be. It should have been. I think if it had been different and Hillary hadn't been the Democratic candidate, I don't think Trump would have won. I really don't. I don't think that would have happened. But we're seeing all kinds of backlash here. And it's not a good thing. Because regardless of whether or not I would have voted, which I really... There was neither one of them that I thought was better than the other. So I can't say I would have voted for Hillary or I would have voted for Trump, because I just didn't like either one of them. But people are very angry right now because of what he stands for and the things that have been happening since he was, you know, announced that he will be our next president. There have been racist hate crimes happening all over the country. Just the most horrible things you can imagine have been happening. And then the people that don't want to see that, that knew this was coming, are rising up and they're rioting. And it's all going the wrong way. Everybody's panicking. And look, you know, once this election is said and done, it's no longer, you know, a matter of, you know, what we can say or do at that point. We have to move forward with this choice that America has made. So we now have to stand together with the decision that's been made and move forward with love in our hearts and kindness towards others, and just continue to work personally and together towards the world we want to live in on a local level. Because we are still the people, and the power is still in the people, and the people need to remember that. The president does have a lot of power, but the power is limited. And everybody needs to remember that. And instead of being angry, they just need to refocus that energy and just move forward and say, okay, you know what? This is something I can't change now because it's already a done deal. What I can do is I can start moving forward towards making things happen that I want to see happen. That means, you know, the pipeline protests, we still need to be there on the front lines. Because another thing, you know, related to Trump that we have to look at is it's probably bad news for the Native Americans in North Dakota, because he invested in that pipeline. So the chances of him diverting it now, very slim. We're not going to get any support from him unless we rise up in such masses that they just can't do it. And even though there was a hold put on them, they were ordered to stop. They're ignoring the hold and they're still drilling and doing the pipeline, even though they were told to do nothing for 30 days by the Army Corps of Engineers. So they're completely just ignoring what they've been told, which is breaking the law. I don't understand why nothing is being done against this company, except for that everybody's lining their pockets with oil money right now. It's an interesting time in America. It certainly is. But we're not going to be able to move forward unless we do so together, unless people stop being angry and full of hate and full of fear. I'm sure you guys are probably getting a lot of people that want to move to Australia now.
Yeah, I did actually hear that on the news. Mention of the Canadian website, I think it was the immigration website, went down, and they were doing some analysis on Google searches, and the top searches for the after the election was, you know, how to move to Canada from USA, how to move to Australia from USA, how to move to UK from USA. It was insane. And even, you know, some celebrities are saying the same thing. I think Matt Damon, who seems to be a political activist of in his own right, you know, said if Trump gets in, make room for Australia for my family.
I hate to lose Matt Damon, too, because, you know, he is a powerful voice. I think people don't give him or Ben Affleck the credit that they deserve, but they are incredibly intelligent people. I've had limited interactions with them because I was part of Project Greenlight back in, like, 2000, 2001.
What was that?
It was a deal that they did where it was for screenwriters and filmmakers, where you wrote a screenplay, and in this they would choose one screenplay that they would actually turn into a film for amateur screenwriters. And then it evolved into where it would be that you could get to also, they people could audition to, like, direct. So they would submit amateur videos and stuff. And so one person would be chosen, you know, the writer, they'd make theirs, and one person would be chosen to be the filmmaker that gets to direct it and produce it. So it was a really amazing program that they did. It was, you know, just kind of one of those pay it forward types of things. You know, it was a series on HBO for a while, and I was a part of that community. And so I got to speak with Matt and with Ben, and they're both very intelligent and well-versed people.
You know, sorry to cut you short, but before I forget, you know how Leonardo DiCaprio won the Oscar this year, or the last year, the most recent one. And, you know, Matt Damon for The Martian, I thought, you know, Matt Damon, just he needs an Oscar. Just, you know, the I reckon he would have, like, he would have floored that speech, the acceptance speech. He would have just nailed it. But there's a new movie that Matt Damon is in, which, you know, is probably going to qualify for the next Oscar. A very fantasy-based monsters type, and the acting in there would have... Sorry?
What's this movie?
I don't know the name off the top of my head.
It has.
I'll research it whilst you do a bit of talking. But it's you know, there's dragons and it's the Great Wall of China. So it's this sort of fantasy type of sounds archery, like a lot of archery and magic. Yeah, it's but Matt Damon is you know, just from the preview and the trailer, his performance was impeccable. It was just, you know, he nailed it. So, like, if he doesn't get an Oscar for this one, Jesus. He's got to get one soon, but I just want to hear what his speech would be. I know that it would, like, go viral.
He don't need an Oscar to make a speech. Have you seen the video he did about, you know, our government and how we need to wake
up?
But
you see, this would put the limelight on
that.
It
would give him a bigger audience. It would be a captivative audience. Cause I mean, those award shows, it's just like a bunch of rich people patting each other on the back.
I was going to say it's like the Oscars, but, but it is. It's a self-glorification stage. It's a Hollywood production on its own. You know?
It really is.
But you know, I know we're talking about celebrities, but you know and I hate to say that, you know, I dislike the whole Hollywood agenda, but let's face it, people trust celebrities that they like.
Yeah.
Well, yes, too much, but also the ones that I like. I mean, for example, I like Matt Damon.
Yeah.
And I would, you know, support anything he says. And just because, you know, people resonate with certain celebrities, whether they'd be singers, actors, even directors like Spielberg or Lucas, you know, in their fantasy sort of genres, they do have a position of power per se. And they, I would say that they have a responsibility to do what's right for the greater humanity.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that they should use their positions
for
carefully.
Good things. Yeah.
And yes, for good things, of course. That's where I sit with that. And, you know, I would like to accept Matt Damon to come live in Australia. You know, WA, all the way. Come live in WA.
Yeah, but I think he would do so much good being here to help people move forward in a positive way without letting it, you know, just giving up. Because we can't just give up on our country because we're worried about, you know, what this president's going to do. That's all the more reason to stick it out and to keep fighting, keep working towards what we want.
Period.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. That transition period is crucial for the what would I say, the morale of the American people,
you know,
and even for the world, you know.
Yeah, in some of his policies, you know, I almost actually think Trump will be okay. My greatest concern is the racism that we're seeing right now, the increase in the racism, and I'm worried on whether or not, you know, what he's doing is going to make that problem worse. So we'll just, this is kind of a wait and see right now. But you
what
know,
is the racism problem like? Okay. So what's Trump, is Trump perceived as a racist or what's the deal?
Yeah. There's people spray painting, Make America White Again, and just all kinds of stuff. They're
Think about it this way.
LGBT.
Anti like gay and homosexual and lesbian. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, think about it this way. You could consider then Trump a torch that is shining the light against the people who have been thinking about being that way. But
well, they're being exposed
themselves
for who they really
exactly,
are.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So you can look at it. You can look at it positive from every angle, right? From anything that happens, you can take a positive about it. And that is, you know, when you go over the top, right? When the crime, when it goes from being exposed to them then utilizing their newfound misfortune and start committing crimes against those that, you know, that they're not liking. But then this person who found those emails, there's an indication that Trump wants martial law.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, this person's really scared. Yeah.
That is scary.
That may be his own doing. If people are coming out committing these crimes against humanity, you know, against the homosexuals and against people of different color or different race, he may have done that intentionally to introduce martial law to hold everyone.
Incite the riots so that it's necessary.
Yeah.
But, you know, I've heard that from everything I've seen, Trump is a conspiracy theorist, which is probably why so many people in the community support him.
Yeah.
It sounds like, you know, he's said that he's going to reopen the investigation into 9/11. So there are definitely, you know, if it's true, right, if this is true, there are things that he's doing that would be positive towards a more, I guess, transparency in government.
Mm-hmm.
He also made a comment in 2012 that the Electoral College was a disaster for America. Now, if that was his real opinion, and this was before he started running for president, it would be a wonderful thing if he actually, you know, got it out of there finally, if he was the person to get rid of it, even though it is responsible for him being president-elect right now because Hillary did get the popular vote.
Okay, so
but having said that, he's already won. He won by the electoral colleges.
So basically, majority of people voted Clinton, but Trump wins because of the percentage that each state holds.
And that is exactly the same reason that Bush became president the first time as well, because Al Gore had the popular vote by quite a bit, actually, but Bush was still president.
That to me, by default, that says that certain states have more power over other states.
Yeah.
That's not fair,
right.
Is it?
No. That's exactly why. That's exactly why something needs to be done about it. That's exactly why, you know, I've been saying for some time now that we have to, you know, make some serious changes in the way this country is run, in the way that we elect our officials, in the powers that they have. And actually, my husband wrote a book last month that got published about our situation in America right now. And the funny thing is we're really aligned. Well, he sees it as we need to get rid of the two-party system in that people don't run as Republican or Democrat. Everybody runs as an independent individual. And therein, people have to base their votes based on what that person's standing is on the issues and not what party they're affiliated with.
Okay.
Yeah.
How's this for a curveball? Do you know a gentleman by the name of Stuart Swerdlow?
I've heard the name.
Okay, so you may have heard of him because I may have brought him up in the past. I used to follow his work to a T since 2002 and sort of started tapering off in about 2010, 2011 and sort of just kept up to date since then. But he was the guy that I put on a pedestal and believed everything that came out of his mouth, right? I've become a little bit not critical, what's the word, a bit more self-sustaining, so I would actually I wouldn't follow it just because he said it. But there was one thing he did predict, which hasn't come to fruition yet, and he said that the United States would be divided into five separate nations. So it would become as part of like the North American Union, and therefore you'd have five presidents. And it would be divided into five districts or five sections, and you know, you could have Trump leading one area, Clinton leading another, and that would be considered different countries as part of the North American Union.
That's interesting.
But he did predict that, and he says that that was the agenda of the New World Order. And he did say that that would try put in a president that would take lead into making this happen, because the American people would be so divided that it would be forced to separate.
They're already actually talking about this. California is already wanting to break away.
Well, there you go.
Yeah. So, you know, we may see this happen. You know, it's been threatened before that Texas would break away and become its own nation. We could see, you know, the collapse of the United States as a whole, as at least one nation, one united nation. So, you know, I don't know. And that's why, you know, I would rather see us try to make that change in a positive way.
As I said, everything can be taken in a positive and negative way. It depends on which side of the fence you want to sit on.
Yeah.
But, you know, looking at it positively and seeing good results from whatever happens is obviously the best way to go. Of course, sitting in the on the side of the fence where your hatred towards your fellow human being who is, you know, flesh and bone and blood and skin, regardless of the color of those features and regardless of what genetics makes those things, you are still human.
Yeah.
And to compare yourself on such a superficial level, I truly believe that we are spiritual beings, and honestly, we all come from the same place. You know, we may have different perspectives of what that location is, But everything is made out of the same thing. I mean, just the judgment of others just based on their race, skin, color, creed, religion, whatever, is just disgusting, in my opinion.
I know, yeah.
So I judge someone by their actions, not their beliefs.
I want to think that we've gotten to a point, you know, where this isn't, you know, where people have evolved, but we still have so many people who just, they cling to that difference as, you know, as if it's a vital part of what makes them who they are. That, hey, my skin is white, so, you know, I'm better than everybody else. You know, the thing that I've noticed is I think racism stems a lot from self-loathing and a lack of self-esteem in other areas. And so the person doesn't see a lot of things about themselves that make them feel really good about who they are. So they cling to that one thing, like a life raft in the middle of an ocean, you know, is saying, well, I might not be this or this or this, but I'm white. I don't know.
They want to be, is it that they have a feeling of being alone and they need something to associate and
maybe
connect with?
But that's the whole point of not being racist, is that yes, you do exactly. have that connectivity, because we're all one human species. We're all humans. We're all human beings. It doesn't matter. The color of our skin is just indicative of where our ancestors, you know, lived way back when.
Because it's not like you had a choice, really, either.
No.
You're born into your family.
Yeah.
I mean, you do have the people saying that you probably chose to be part of that genetics, you know, spiritually speaking. But that aside, let's look at it in the material way. You were born into a family. Let's say you had no choice, and you were judging someone else based on the fact that they had no choice on that. And you're hating someone because they had no choice on that. And I mean, that's not really fair.
It just doesn't make sense.
It's prejudice. Is that the word, prejudice?
Prejudice. Yes.
That's against right something. Word. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's, you know, my wife wants me to watch Pride and Prejudice. That's why I thought of that word. Apparently, it's eye-opening in a topic, and my fancy is obviously more modern day films, but it may be something worthwhile.
There's a modern version of it called Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies. And even though...
Oh, okay.
I'm not kidding you. But you know what? Even though it's kind of comically funny, it still hits the core fundamentals of the story as a whole. It still hits the pride and the prejudice in the story. So it'd still be, you know, if you don't want to watch something that's going to bore you to tears, you might watch that.
Okay. I'm not really a zombie fan. You know, I don't like...
You don't like The Walking Dead?
I don't like I've never seen it. I'm not a dystopian believer. Like, I really prefer...
Oh, no, utopian. I'm not either. No, I'm not either.
But the whole Walking Dead and... I suppose because when I was young, I was about 6 or 7, I watched Return of the Living Dead, and that scared the absolute bejesus out of me. And also Child's Play and Nightmare on Elm Street. So, yes, I don't like the horror genre very much. I suppose because I, you know, opened myself up before I was 18. But in saying that, what's the realistic future that this planet has? Is it going to be utopian or dystopian? I mean, that's really the only two choices you got. Either a world that works coherently. I think it will be utopian,
because what we're looking at right now, you know, Elon Musk is wanting to colonize Mars. Now, who is going to Mars? Only people who can afford $200,000 to $2 million a ticket, which means all of the wealthy and the elite are moving off planet. Guess what that means? We get it back. We, that's the average person, get it back, which means we get to let the planet heal, because they're the ones that are destroying it. The super wealthy really and powerful are destroying it with the factories, the tearing down, and fracking. Oh, my gosh. Did you hear about our earthquake? We had a nice, big, fat earthquake in Oklahoma last week. It was 5.3, I think, or 5.6, something like that. But I felt it. My husband felt it. We felt it immediately. And we were nowhere near the epicenter, but we felt the ground shaking. I'm like, what is going on? I was like, we just had an earthquake. Yeah. It was big. It was felt by several states. The epicenter was in Oklahoma, but it was probably about 90 miles from us. So, we got quaked, and this was a direct result of fracking, because there is a lot of fracking in Oklahoma by the oil companies. They're taking that wastewater and they're just slamming it into the earth, and they're breaking up the crust, and they're causing this instability, which is making Oklahoma has now surpassed California as being the earthquake capital of the United States. Yeah. How crazy is that?
And California was right up, you know, was and quite just badly.
A couple of decades ago, we rarely ever had an earthquake.
You know, you were mentioning about Mars and Earth. Mm-hmm. There is a dystopian TV series called The Expanse. It's only season one, I think, at the moment. And I just started watching it on Netflix.
I think my husband watches that.
It's brilliant. I mean, it talks about the Mars colony, series colony called the Belters, who go into the asteroid belt and mine for ice. So that ice can be turned into, obviously, water and oxygen. Right. And hydrogen, obviously, so fuel, and that, and in the belt, and Mars, the highest commodity is air and water. On Earth, of course, it's still gold and whatnot. Right. And the whole dystopian dysfunction is the Belters versus the Martians versus the Earthlings or the Earthers, and it sort of puts this whole human versus human polarity on a new level. It's like, you're still human, guys. I mean, you're fighting just because you were born like off planet,
a different place,
and but the one thing that it makes it awesome is that even though they are a belter, there's an Asian belter, you know, genetically connected to the Asians. There's Indian belters. There's American, Australian, and they don't care about where their genetics are from on Earth.
Right.
The very fact that they're belters, they unite. So that's the positive that I saw that this theme TV show was making. And of course you go to Earth and then they're still fighting based on their own races or, you know, but that's a really good TV show. I really recommend it, The Expanse.
Yeah. I know for a fact that's the one he was watching. I think I've seen a few episodes about, of it. Cause I remember there was some woman that was missing that they were trying to find or something like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Really Mal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. So I don't think I saw the whole season, but I did see some of the episodes about it, and it did look very interesting. The idea behind it, certainly one that, you know, it raises, I think it almost kind of goes, you know, the opposite of Star Trek in a world that, you know, doesn't come together and unite. It splits apart into separate pieces, and that's
it
not the world.
It realistic.
That's not the world I want, though. I want to see Gene Roddenberry's world. I
want
to see Gene Roddenberry's world realized. You know, I think people like that are influenced. I think they are given a muse.
Gene Roddenberry is a visionary, it may come in dreams, but
there are people that will say that they may be getting, you know, the inspiration, you know, behind their ideas is coming from an outside source that is suggesting these things to them, especially when they talk about the Federation of Planets and things like that. I think these ideas that came to him are things that actually exist, and I don't think we're ready to join them yet. But I think that it's possible that it already exists. When you look at Nikola Tesla's work, he said many times that a lot of the things and the ideas that he got came to him, they weren't his own ideas, that they were given to him. And he
made a connection to the Sirius beings from Sirius A and Sirius B, apparently. And actually, that's my handle, Sirius Unc, because of Nicola's connection to Sirius, and I did my investigation to that. But yes, he did say, and he was called crazy towards the final years of his life, because he was saying that he was in communication with the beings from Sirius. And that his ideas for technology were from the Sirius star system.
Which makes perfect sense, doesn't it?
Well, it does, especially when people like Stuart, for example, says that beings from Sirius A are one of the most technologically advanced beings in the Milky Way. And he supposedly time traveled and space traveled and went to Mars and other planets. This is someone that's alive right now.
Yeah.
Just for people to want, if they want to do their own research. But, you know, the what I want to bring up is your comment about inspiration, about the muse.
Yeah.
And there was a Deep Space Nine episode specifically called The Muse. It was, I forgot the captain's son's name, but the son would get massaged in the temples by this alien being, and the energy would make him be inspired to create awesome poetry and awesome stories. And it was downloaded through this alien being.
Wow.
But what I found myself, my inspiration through things that I like to do when it comes to creativity is through my own difficulties in life. So, you know, I've been labelled as being schizophrenic and borderline personality and now looking at perhaps being ADD. But those things don't define me. They give me access to a perspective that, you know, other people don't usually have, other than obviously those who have a similar diagnosis. But each individual's journey is unique.
Exactly.
And I find that I know the most about myself than I know about anyone else, right? So I know more about myself than anyone else.
Of course.
And when it comes to creativity, is even just a little bit of exaggeration on my experiences can make a fantastic science fiction novel or just, you know, like I'll give one idea, right? So a dystopian future where it's expensive and resource intensive to monitor a certain individual. So all you have to do is design a chemical or a drug where you feed to the population and it makes them paranoid. So they believe they're being monitored and being followed, but they're really not. So it's their own delusion.
Huh.
And you've basically succeeded in doing the monitoring thing because they believe they're being monitored, so they start behaving. Because if they believe they're being followed and being monitored, they're going to start changing the way they behave.
Yeah.
And you're not actually doing anything. It's their own delusion that's feeding that fear, and therefore you've achieved your goal. And the reason I thought of that idea is because I thought that was happening to me.
Yeah.
You know, so in the year 2001, or specifically 2000/2001, that New Year's, I ingested a chemical which gave me a three-month induced psychosis, and I thought I was being followed for 3 months. And then later on I thought, well, what if the drug just made me think that and I made myself believe my own delusions or thoughts of paranoia, and there wasn't actually any monitoring. I just believed there was, and I distinctly changed my behavior within that 3 months, and I became a totally different person.
Wow.
Prior to 2001, I would have considered to be my, the most arrogant, racist, hateful person, you know, that I would have that I would have ever known. Since then, because of that 3 month induced psychosis, I was self-analyzing and realizing that that wasn't the best sort of way to live and best way to think. And so my whole character changed, but it was out of choice or forceful choice.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, sorry, just going back to my initial thing was about the creativity aspect of it. You know, people can be inspired and can create based on their own experiences. And I think a lot of singers, songwriters, you know, artists obviously write songs and play music or create poetry based on their own life experiences. And I really think that the future of this world should be based on an education system that allows children to express their creativity and not their logical left brain. You know,
I think that's a good idea.
You know, education, if we're going to go in the logical sense, should be based on educating someone on how to budget, for example, or how to cook and
You know,
cook their own meals.
Real world experience.
Yeah. Because I mean, I don't know that A squared plus B squared equals C squared is going to save my life, you know, out in the desert somewhere if I break down. You know, I know that that's what makes the length of the whatever the length of the longest side of a triangle, equilateral triangle. But you know, in real life world situations, it's not going to help me save my life. First aid should be a priority.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yep. First aid.
I agree.
And that's the utopian future that I'm hoping to see.
Well, that's like the non elitist future. You know, yes. It goes against pretty much everything they want. I think that's why we have. You were mentioning about, you know, how you had that realization, and it was kind of, you know, a result of what you experienced, you know, mm-hmm. with that chemical. But that I think that's why we have so many psychedelics and hallucinogenics that are illegal.
Mm-hmm.
Is because they also bring about an understanding and awareness. When people have certain ones like ayahuasca, you know, even mushrooms, things like that, they will bring people into a state of mind where they start to see a bigger picture, and they start to see things from an outside point of view, and they actually get to reevaluate who they are and look at the things they're doing wrong in their life. Mm-hmm. This is bad news for the elite because they don't want people to, you know, be at peace with their life, to be okay with this and to say, no, I don't like that anymore. And I'm reject that. And I'm not going to be stressed anymore about this. Because we're not as easily controlled if we That's resolve right. all these things, if we have that insight, if we get a greater clarity of mind, that makes us not easy to control. And of course, if they can't control us, then their, you know, end game agenda isn't going to be successful. They have to have us believe that we are slaves, believe that we have no options, believe that, you know, we have to accept what is given to us, and that is it.
Okay, so think about this as a possibility. And, you know, I know a lot of conspiracy theorists and freedom fighters are going to probably shoot me for this. But let's say that the elite are intentionally making this invisible prison system and this whole mind control. Let's say that is correct. But what if the intention was to awaken the human spirit so that it does liberate itself from such control?
It's possible. But when we talk in terms of the elite, you know, the word that comes up often is the Illuminati. I've mentioned this in the past, but, you know, we always have new listeners. So, you know, to anybody who's not heard this before, I believe personally that there are two separate organizations that would be understood as the Illuminati. One is what everybody sees as, you know, the evil organization that is set up to control everything and put people into a slave reality. The other, and perhaps they're working with them, but I don't think so, were originally known as the Council of Light. And this goes back to Atlantis. Mm-hmm. They broke, basically split up into two different factions because some of them became very corrupt.
So like the gray, I would call them the gray hats.
Exactly. Okay.
Yeah. Then you got the white and light, so and then the black light.
So there's two separate Illuminati now. Some that are there to help raise humans' consciousness and bring us into a peaceful future and help us achieve. And the other ones are trying to hold us back and keep us grounded in the physical and the non-spiritual, because that makes us easier to control. But
why would they want to control those? So is that so that they can have the system, the life that they can want to
feed off of our energy?
Okay. So they do understand the spiritual aspects of things?
Yeah.
They're not just physical manifestations? Okay.
No. Yeah, carry on. Not just, no. Mm-hmm. Because the Council of Light were not human. They were not human. They weren't
from
this
high
planet.
Dimensions.
Yeah, higher dimensions. Not from, like, we would understand it, like, you know, our planet. However, kind of, but overlapping, I would say. Yeah.
Carry on. I'm going to research something quickly. But I do know that there's a technical term for the dark. There's a slow progression-based Illuminati and a fast-paced progression. So it depends on which faction.
So you've actually heard something to this extent before?
Yep. Yes, there's one called the Fabian Society. I think actually, Okay, that's so interesting. It's called the Fabian Illuminati, but the Fabian mm-hmm. Society itself is a British socialist organization whose purpose is to advance the principles of democratic socialism via gradualist and reformist effort in democracies rather than revolutionary overthrow. So the Fabian Illuminati are slow, gradual, chess pieces right. sort of movement. And then there's the opposition, and I don't know their name, but I'm just going to search for it. I'm going to search for Antithesis. Okay. Right. And that's the Marxist. There we go. The Marxist-based Illuminati,
okay.
which are based on revolutionary overthrowing.
Huh.
So, yeah. So that's the two types of Illuminati that I know of that are part of the dark side. Then I did know that there was also the, as you said, you called them Council of Light. I didn't.
That is something that came to me, like, basically channeled, which I don't have happen very often, but this literally, this is like a vision that I got, and my hand just started writing it down as it came to me. There's no other way. I was just guided to write it. And that's not something that happens very often. But I pay attention to things like that when they do. And then dreams followed, which kind of showed me the bigger picture of what I was writing, what actually happened and stuff. So I've actually seen this Council of Light. And the thing is, the experience that I had with, I don't know how to describe this. When we had a lot of paranormal activity, and I know I've mentioned this, you've probably heard the story before, but I had asked my guardians to help us with it. And that night there was a huge bright light shining in our window, and we didn't have neighbors with back lights. There's no source because we were on the top of a hill in the middle of woods. But I wouldn't go out to look at it. And I woke up in a room surrounded by these tall, illuminated white beings. So I've seen them.
Okay.
During that experience, and there was an exchange of information, and this was probably about 6 or 7 years ago. Yeah, it was about 6 or 7 years ago.
Yep.
Yeah. And
carry on. I want to hear it again because, you know, there may be some listeners who haven't heard it before.
Yeah. Well, the thing that led up to it, I mean, we had just extreme paranormal activity. My kids' room, the closet doorknobs were turning back and forth while they were asleep. And, you know, I walk by, I'd hear the door turning back and forth. So I walk in there and, of course, you know, open the door. There's nothing in there. My daughters heard it. They got up out of bed and it starts doing it again, even though we know there's nothing in there. The knob starts flipping back and forth. My oldest daughter, brave as she is, she just grabbed that door and just ripped it open and turned on the light and searched that closet, and there was nothing in there. And she closes that door, and behind us is the door that is the entry to the room, and it's halfway open so we can see both sides of the door, and that knob starts turning back and forth.
Wow.
And so we could see both sides. We could see there was nothing turning it.
And nothing on either side, and right. It was still turning.
Yeah. It got really dramatic that night, and my youngest daughter, we went into the girls' room and we just kind of sat up and talked. We could not wake up the boys for the life of us. We tried everything. We couldn't wake them up. We couldn't wake my husband up. When we were in their room, she saw orbs floating back and forth in their room. Things had gotten really serious. So that night, this was all during the time when I was experiencing my shamanic awakening. So we were having other signs too. This is around the same time that the Thunderbird showed up for me. So I was reminded of the time when I was a young girl and the woman in white came to me. I was about 4 years old. And somehow the memory came with that, and I understood that I could call up for help when I needed to. And I don't know why, because I was told I wouldn't remember what she said until the time was right. And I don't remember her telling me that, but it was something I understood when I was remembering it. So I projected my thoughts upward and asked them to either help with the situation or to help me solve the situation on my own. And then that was the night, later that night. And my dog went crazy earlier that night too. He actually got stuck down in like this ravine, rabbit hole type thing. He was freaking out, chasing something down there. We couldn't find anything. But yeah, and then later that night, this bright white light was shining into our window of our bedroom, and where this window is, okay, it's kind of, there was a neighbor's house right next to it, and then nothing but, you know, on the lower side, it was like a forest with a hill going way down, so there was nothing back there. Our neighbor didn't have a backlight, and this light was so bright. It was like, you know, just super bright. I kind of was so nervous about it that I just didn't want to look, because I kind of knew it wasn't something normal, you know.
Okay.
That light was too bright. So I ignored it and I wouldn't go look.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to sleep, and I woke up, and I was in I call it a room, but I don't think it was a room, and it's hard to explain. I think it was in another plane almost. Mm-hmm. Because there were no walls, but there was white light all around me everywhere. Yep. It was just white, pure light. And I was surrounded by these tall beings. They had some sort of gown or robe. They weren't like clothing, but they were clothed. But it was kind of like a draped robe or something.
Mm-hmm.
But the robe was like luminescent too. It was like pure white light as well.
Yeah.
And
were they elongated heads?
I couldn't see their faces. I wasn't allowed to look up. That's the thing. I could see to their shoulders, and either I was made to not remember it, or mm-hmm. I was just not allowed to look up, and I knew I couldn't look up at their faces. But it's I could only see them from the shoulders down.
Okay.
In
could
front
you see
of
their
me,
hands?
I didn't notice any hands.
Okay. So you just basically were aware of their stature rather than...
Yeah, they were surrounding me in a circle. They were around me in a circle. They were probably about 3 feet, each of them, from me in a circle.
Mm-hmm.
And in front of me was something suspended in the air. And I don't really know how to explain it. It wasn't solid, but it was like images and things. And it was constantly shifting and changing shape. And I understood, although they didn't speak to me per se, that I was being given information and they were taking information from me. So it was an exchange of info happening.
Yeah.
And the next morning, everything stopped. All the paranormal activity stopped. There was no more problems. Whatever happened, it resolved our issue, at least until we moved.
Oh, goodness. So that protected the area rather than your...
Yeah. And we were followed when we moved. We had red light UFO craft that followed us. They were stationary in the sky. They didn't move. They were low, and they were like a red light. And then there were two of them, and they actually like switched positions with each other as we were going. I guess they had to be moving because they were like following us, but they were literally at the same point to us as we were traveling. Sure. So it looked like they weren't moving.
As you move 10 feet, that would move 10 feet.
Right, exactly.
That weren't moving, but yeah, it's all better perspective.
And the funny thing was, is my mother-in-law was the first one to notice them.
Was she a non-believer prior to that point?
Well, no. She's the one that was actually saw the body from Roswell, because she worked for the Pentagon back when the Roswell crash happened. And so,
okay, that may be your connection, sorry to say. You know, the very fact that, you know, a relative worked for the Pentagon, that could be default position for you to experience what you did. Carry on.
So, yeah, anyways, they followed to our following house, and it wasn't long before. It always takes time for whatever it is that follows us to find us. Usually it's at least 3 months before activity starts again, which I find very strange. I've never understood that. I mean, if this is something that has the ability to follow, why doesn't it follow instantly? Why does it take so long to show up?
Could it be a family manifestation? And I mean,
well, very possible. I mean, there is a certain magnetic, you know, field, I think, that people who are spiritual, especially healers, send out that draws, you know, entities to them. And all of the kids are very spiritual healers. At least three of them are definitely on that path already. So, and they all had paranormal experiences from as young as I did. And so when we got to the new house, you know, about a few months in, you know, we started with shadow beings showing up and some very dramatic, shadow being experiences that happened. Some very weird stuff.
I would like to get your opinion and your perspective on something that happened to me when I was, 5 and a half.
Okay.
It was 1 week before we were moving to Australia. Mm-hmm. And, I remember distinctly being a Saturday. I usually slept naked at that age. I remember, you know, just the event.
Right.
And what happened, my mother answered the door and there were five people, four gentlemen and one female, very tall. The woman was blonde haired. The men were black hair, mm-hmm. and they all had blue eyes. I just distinctly remember that was just very predominant right. feature that I'll recall. And they were all wearing black, like the Freemason sort of attire that right. they would wear, the black tuxedo. I mean, they weren't specifically Freemasonic, but
just that type of style.
With a black tie, not a bow tie, but actual ties for the men and a black dress for the lady. They came into my room and I woke up sort of groggily. And it wasn't a spiritual experience, although it may be underlining, but it was a physical experience. And mm-hmm. I remember they were asking me questions, questions like, are you looking forward to going to Australia? Who is your father or your brother already there, which they were. And just quickly, they did say, and I remember saying in English, they were saying it in English because I don't remember what they said back then, but they said, you'll do us proud. And then they left.
Oh, that is interesting.
Mm.
Oh, so no, and we are out of time. This is horrible. you know, we might have to revisit this. Okay. Thank you for tuning in, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend. Good night.
Thank you, everybody. Good night.